Good morning, everyone. Happy March 14th. We are now on episode 44, so I'm starting to think ahead as to what episode 52 is going to look like. I was actually thinking about that yesterday and a little bit this morning. I got a couple ideas, so I want to make episode 52 kind of my first year anniversary of doing this. So, good morning, Brian. So that's what's been pretty much going on. Another interesting week of stuff. So for those that are new, again, the usual disclaimer, morning Dolce, the usual disclaimer, this is all about digital disruption, what's going on, plays off a number of presentations that I've given over the past 2 years specific to disruption. For those new and watching, you know, on my YouTube channel where this eventually ends up, if you go to my YouTube page, which is youtube.com/keeppace, and you click on playlists, you will see that there is a disruption playlist full of 43 videos. I think it's, I forget how many hours it is. There's a site out there that if you give it a playlist, it calculates how many hours it is. I forget how many it is at this point, but keeps growing by a half an hour at a time. And yes, Jay, happy Pi Day. So I will tell my... I will tell my favorite Mad Magazine joke on the topic, where it was Archimedes. Today in history, Archimedes draws his first circle, discovers it's as easy as pie. Ha ha ha. So there's your Pi Day joke. Again, what do we do over this course of the next, 25 minutes or so? It's primarily a breakdown of various articles. So rather than just focus on the wow factor, we really get into what's the big picture, what are the drivers, some of the detailed pieces of this, and that's pretty much what we do for the next 25 minutes. So, again, most of the articles this week fell into the business category, I guess, on my framework. What I would suggest is, as I was reading through this, it kind of gave me a current state and a future state, in a sense. Good morning, Wanda. I hope you set you moved your clock ahead. So all of these, as I go through these today, I want you to think of this from two perspectives. One of which is what's going on in your current company. What are some of the things you should be looking out for? And the other one is ways to get ready for an interview, and certain questions or certain insights that you might be looking for, because I'm sure companies are going through these. Various transformations, and these are going to give some insights as to what you might want to look for or consider. So the first one, hang on, business, did I do this right? Yeah. So the first one was relatively straightforward, but embodied, this was from a site, DC Velocity. I had never heard of those. And the title was Retail Group Says Emergence from Pandemic Will Lead to Urgent Transformation, Not a New Normalcy. And I like the header. And, you know, as we look through some of these pieces, again, for those that have been following along, good morning, Anthony. For those that have been following along, there's nothing that I would consider here to be a net new. Rather, it emphasizes or at least highlights some of the things that we've consistently talked about. So the first thing is they have their acronym here, and their acronym was CPG, which is over here. So when you see CPG here, it's consumer packaged goods sector. So, you know, things that they, and again, I just saw these as interesting discussion points. So demand for these consumer packaged goods stays elevated due to a slow emergence from the pandemic, combined with long-term or permanent lifestyle changes. And that's really what caught my attention. We are in this new normal. Muscle memory has been created. So these are the types of things that to expect it to revert back to where it was, you have to temper that expectation. There's some change. Where on that pendulum or where on that spectrum we're going to end isn't clear, but it's clear that there's permanent changes or there's the start of changes that this past year has implemented. Again, something we talked about last year in depth was about the supply chain innovation. So if you're looking for a new category to go into, I think anything having to do with supply chain is going to be one. And, you know, this is interesting. It just says supply chain innovation returns to a role behind the scenes as consumers care that store shelves stay stocked. right? So there's the expectation if I go to the store, I want to buy it, it's there. But as we know, it's all the dynamics of where is it built? How does it get there? How is the demand change based on, you know, an event that we can't plan for? So I think you're going to see a fair amount of work around supply chain. And that, again, we've talked about that, geez, probably a year ago. So you can go back to the videos and look at it here. Urgency is renewed to fix a broken recycling system. I have read, you know, not that I've read actively, but was it last year or sometime last year? I was reading about, you know, all the different challenges that, you know, these recycling programs aren't as good as they could be. So that's interesting because there's been an increase in plastic usage and waste during the pandemic. So, you know, again, as that pendulum swings and blah, blah, blah. Digital transparency accelerates to meet consumer expectations. We talked about this last year, and government requirements, and a new digital fluency after a year of virtual living. Again, remember, a lot of things got accelerated. So, again, this is part of that new normal. And companies become societal change agents based on increased trust earned during the pandemic. So, obviously, those that stepped up, there's a you know, people tend to go with those companies that align with their thinking. So again, nothing here should be a surprise, but more of a reminder. So there's change. Some of this is going to be permanent. What's the fallout? And that's really how I would go back, read this article and start thinking, you know, what's that pattern and how does it apply to what you do? Now, the next one, it was kind of interesting, and I may be jumping back and forth. Is this the right one? Why did I make this backwards? Enterprise project, why is this off? Because there's two. Hang on a second. What did I do here? How did I mess this one up? Oh, so my, give me a second here. I what did I do here? I got my three trends, five trends. Why is it five trends? It was three trends. Oh, I hate when this happens. What happened here? All right, well, let me do a... What's my next one after this? At least I get the next two right. Is your C-suite, right? Is your C-suite? I'll tell you what, I'll put this one toward the end because I don't remember what the heck I did there. Okay, I hate when this happens. All right, the next one, business. So this one, digital transformation, three driving trends for 2021. So you're going to start seeing different viewpoints now on transformation and this whole preparation for 2021. And watch how each of these articles kind of takes a different perspective on the space, which I think is interesting. So the first one, and I really did like this first one. And again, this is from the enterprisersproject.com. So the first one, transformation is ready to mean transformation again. So, you know, this whole thing of at the height of the pandemic, companies were forced to innovate. They do so quickly. Well, now you've established a new baseline. And off of that baseline, there's two approaches. One of which is, okay, we transformed. Here's our new normal. And you continue on that path. Or you now take that fundamental change or that fundamental foundation and you continue to innovate. And I think this is one of those interesting aspects of if your culture has just gone through that shock of change, don't lose it, right? The idea here is, oh, okay, we changed. You know, we kind of checked the check. We've checked the box, I'm sorry, on our transformation. We're transformed and we're done. And that's probably the wrong way to think about this. It's more along the lines of, hey, we've transformed. How do we continue that energy or that that culture, and how do we move that forward? So that's one of the first ones. Generational change will change business behavior. This just talks about, you know, how a whole generation has come in and experienced this, you know, complete remote and digital onboarding process. And you have a, you know, it's this whole idea of these younger people are now coming into the marketplace. And what are they going to do to impact what businesses sell or the markets that they're serving? So again, that shouldn't come as a surprise, but it's been highlighted through this pandemic. And the last one I thought was very interesting, and this gets us back kind of in a sense to supply chain. Resilience building technology is more important than big bang innovation. So, you know, where was number three here? You know, in 2021, they'll need to do the simple things using technology to better make technology better to make their organizations more resilient. So, again, we saw the shock from what COVID is. So I think one of the, you know, as people are trying to transform, I think there's this other one that gets us back to the culture of, well, you know, how do we make sure that this can't happen to us again, or how are we better prepared for it? So again, the first, these first three things of what's going to drive businesses in 2021 gets back to kind of put these down almost as a checklist for questions that you would ask for a company that you're interviewing. And where are they? What is their thinking around transformation? Are they, did they not transform during this? Did they transform and they're happy where they're at? Or their transformation has changed their company culture? That's kind of a spectrum that you need to figure out. Is that where you want to be? Or is that the type of company you want to align with? So that's kind of step one. Now, step two. The next one gets into interesting stuff. And there was actually, you may have to register for this one. This is Harvard Business Review. I think you get three, you know, you get the so many free articles, then you have to register. I think this one required, if it wasn't this one, it was CIO, required a business email address. So this one gets into some survey work that they did back to, and two paragraphs really caught my attention. So according to one survey, now this was from the 2016, was this the one? I just want to double check here. I think this was the one from 2016. Where was it? Was both of these had, right. So this was company, they looked at job postings from January 2016 to June 2020. So let's go back to get to these two paragraphs so that I can kind of give you the thought that I think you should extract from this. So according to one survey, 77% of CEOs reported that the pandemic sped up their company's digital transformation plans. We talked about that all last year. We've seen 2 years worth of digital transformation in 2 months. Again, we talked about that last year. A study conducted by Twilio found that COVID-19 accelerated companies' digital communication strategies by an average of 6 years. So this whole train has ended up moving faster over a very short period of time. And again, we've talked about this matching of, you know, you don't have these long windows to acquire these skills, especially as this train is moving forward. Now, the problem is, if all the trains are moving forward, the question is, where are you finding all of these people with the necessary skills? So it's a very interesting dynamic to start with. Now, here's the real key, and this gets back to personal preparation, alignment with a company's direction, alignment with a company's strategy. We think the next few years will see a revolution for many top management roles. The pandemic has exposed the executives who were not up to the challenge of a rapid technological pivot. In some cases, it has become clear that the wrong leaders are in place, and the only thing standing in the way of a replacement is the lack of a suitable successor. Once boards and top, and then it goes on, you know, we will likely see tremendous amounts of turnover in a very turbulent environment that will highlight the chasm between the digitally savvy haves and the traditional have-nots. Oh my God, what a great paragraph. But let's break that down a little bit. And I thought it was interesting if you go a little bit here, and I'm sorry for the eye chart, but if you go further down, one of the things that they looked at is where they wanted this first one, tech or digital, as part of a job description. And as you go down into some of these other, like supply chain officer, chief legal officer, the ask wasn't as great. And personally, I think that's just wrong, because if you don't understand the space and you don't understand the vision, let's just take technology for a second. If you're coming at this with old school technology, old school thinking, I'm sorry, you know, in the legal space, you're thinking about the traditional shrink wrap. How did you work with vendors? You know, the traditional delivery mechanisms. Well, now it's all online. What are the new rights? What are the new expectations? What are the new requirements for audit? this whole digital transformation is going to touch every single one of those roles. And I think the real challenge or problem is that if you're looking for these jobs going forward, and I've said this numerous times, people are probably sick of hearing me say it, if you're focusing on what you've done and the fact that you're really good at it, great. But these companies are all up to this new challenge of, well, it's transforming what we do. How do we adopt? How do we figure out how to take all of this net new and not only align with certain business requirements that haven't necessarily gone away, but the new requirements that are coming out? What does that new model look like? And this gets this, like, there's so many different levels. There's the management level of this. There's the vision and strategy piece of this. But this Harvard Business Review really, in the way I look at it, really highlights this. If you can't find the people that do it, well, what are they lacking? To me, you're really lacking this vision. You're lacking the understanding the rules of the game. You're lacking, you know, how this new model works. So rather than being the consumer of it and being in the ecosystem, you want to be the person that's in the ecosystem that says, well, wait a minute, I understand the ecosystem and here's what it really needs to look like, or here's how we drive that change. So it's an excellent article. I would highly recommend the Harvard Business Review article simply because it's talking, and again, get past the survey. Think about what this means directionally over the next 3 years. What skills, what mind share, what capabilities are you going to need in your particular career so that, you know, you're thinking forward, you're not necessarily thinking static or backward. So that's what I liked about the Harvard Business Review article. The next one, 10 steps to avoid digital transformation failure. Now, I think this was the one on CIO. You have to give an email address on. And, you know, I'm not going to go through all of these. Rather, what I did was I just took the 10. And different ones, again, remember, we're looking at this from two perspectives. Where is your company or the company that you may be interviewing for? So the first, make the business case clear. And one of the things I liked about this, which was right here, you know, it takes out the business jargon. It's unambiguous. It's brief. This business case of what a company is trying to accomplish really needs to be crisply defined, because it's all the downstream systems that are going to change. It's all that culture that's going to change, that if you don't set a clear business case and clear expectations, it's going to be hard to really drive a transformation that aligns to that. Many of these were talking about it from a management perspective. Be the communicator in chief, which was the second one. You know, maybe it's easier to do this one. You know, it's the person that's really making sure that the plans are in place, that the mission and the ambiguity is taken out of the system, and telling people, you know, we can get here, and dealing, you know, it doesn't say it here immediately, but because they talk about bumps and risks, but it's also bringing that culture along and communicating that change, especially when people, you know, change can be scary. Having that person that can lead the team or the organization through that change is going to be important. Hold the organizational accountable. You know, at the end of the day, there's still a certain amount of accountability that needs to happen, but it really is getting to what are the impacts, understanding what the impacts are, what are the capabilities, what can be done, what can't be done. All of that kind of fits into that space. Take care of your team. Well, you know, I think that goes without saying, right? If you treat your team well, if you're really keeping them engaged, you're going to get better results than if you don't. Elevate operational continuity as a priority. This gets into the whole the budgeting piece, right? You know, that that people will report how well things are going, but they tend to hide how things aren't going well. And to me, I think that's one of the challenges through these transformations. And I looked at operational continuity as a different challenge rather than what was explained here, largely because the business still has to operate. And there's this very delicate balance between disrupting it, versus the expectations of what it's bringing in. And this is why a lot of transformations fail, because, you know, if you don't have that balance between the two, you know, you may make decisions that aren't really aligned with number one of what is your, what are you really trying to accomplish? So, lengthened decision lead times, you know, perfect, right? If you say, hey, we're going to go do this in 3 months, and it really is a 6 month project or it's a 12 month project, yeah, you want to try and push to get things done. But at the same point in time, some of these transformations are really going to have a lot of decisions, and some of those decisions may take time to resolve. So, you know, again, it's just part and parcel of the whole article. Be a shot caller. This is just somebody that, you know, somebody needs to make the hard calls at some point in time. This is where the executive sponsorship comes in. This is why you not only need to communicate down, you need to communicate up. Set and communicate priorities. You know, again, this kind of gets back to the operational piece as well. This is a delicate dance, right? Transformation just can't be about transformation, and, you know, the old school can't be about the old school. It's a very sophisticated dance that allows you to take and transform the old to get it to the new. And there's going to be priorities. Do you invest in the old stuff because you have a customer requirement, or are you doing something because the company is facing stiff competition? So that's one of the priorities that needs to get figured out. Leverage your vendors. Yeah, I mean, in theory, they should be a lot closer to understanding some of those transformational pieces. They're not necessarily going to understand your business. But again, the idea is that you can't do this in a silo. That's the takeaway. And then a management reserve. This one just gets back to the whole budgeting, where it's very likely that teams are going to run through their budgets for whatever reason. And if they need an excess, you don't want to say, well, you know, all the money's gone. So they're talking about establishing a reserve. Now, I don't know how many of these I necessarily, you know, all buy into per se. I think it's a matter of taking these 10 and using them as part of really getting back to number one, which is making the business case clear. And I think if you take those other 9 and align them, it starts at least forming a picture that you say, you know, here's what's reasonable for our organization. So, where'd my cursor go? There it is. So, that was the CIO article. Common pitfalls to, is this one now? Let's see something here. I don't know where I got that other article from. Was that the one I had too? Oh, well, anyway, sorry. Now, here's the interesting part. So as we've been going through these, now we get, again, a different lens on the topic. So this one was common pitfalls to avoid. So not having the right digitally savvy leader in charge. Well, we've at least seen that. I think there's a lot to be said for, do you have a person that has that vision, that understands what that next step, that new normal should look like? I think that's really critical. And I would imagine that that's probably in short supply. That's number one. Data infrastructure, data maturity, and the misalignment between strategy and technology. Well, this is another thing that we've talked about over time. One of the things about being digital is you got to make sure that you have the appropriate data across everything. When we talked about this, I think last week too, about customer experience. Well, if you have multiple products, you need to make sure all of the data associated with those products aligns to a customer. So there's a lot that can go wrong here in terms of what you want that future state to be and what your current state is and how do you best align with that. Pursuing the wrong projects, this gets back to the earlier article about prioritization of tasks. Again, it's a very delicate balance of how are you transforming versus, you know, BAU type activities. If you don't have the business case, if you don't have the strategy, this is how you can pursue wrong projects. Building the entire tech stack inside. This is the proverbial buy versus build problem. And in this world where technology becomes commoditized so quickly, building bespoke solutions is probably not the right way to go. When you have capabilities that are off the shelf, probably makes sense to use them. As I mentioned once upon a long time ago, you know, one of the things somebody said to me was, you know, you can sign a non-disclosure form all day long and everybody can have the idea. It's how well you execute on it. So again, I think the buy versus build, if we look at cloud, right? Cloud is buy. Go buy that capability. Why would you build it? That's the general theme. And then understanding cultural challenges. I mean, goodness, there's a litany. This is about your company culture. This is about, you know, people whose jobs could potentially be outsourced, people who feel their jobs are threatened, you know, miscommunication. There gets to a whole lot of challenges when you disrupt processes that have been in place for a period of time. There's a lot of cultural challenges that come. I'll just talk about it that way. So where am I? Oops, was that it? That was it. Wow. I didn't realize I had gone through those so quickly. So this week really was about transformation preparation, transformation current state. To me, this is really about the big picture. What's the competition doing? What's your company doing? How are they aligned? Do they have the right people in? Are they trying to transform with people that they've gotten in from the outside with experience? Are they trying to transform internally? I think there's a lot of questions you should ask as you go through this to say to yourself, does this help give an insight as to how successful these efforts may or may not be? And then I think on a more detailed view, I think, you know, you want to get an idea of how are these projects running? You know, what are the structures? Who's prioritizing the efforts? What do the budgets look like? And I think this begins to give you an insight that when we talk about asking those good questions during an interview, I think it gets to that. So, just want to double check here. So that's what I had for you guys this week. It was maybe not as exciting as previous weeks, but to me, this is one of those assessment type weeks. How do you take these tools, these articles, and really use them in a way to assess not only your current state, and especially if you're running an organization or you're running a certain section of the organization, how do you align that effort? How do you help your management best figure out how to navigate these transformational waters? So I think there's a lot, if you look at these articles and you start extracting those pieces, I think there's a couple of different buckets that they all fit into. So thoughts, questions, answers, yes, Pi Day. Go have a piece of pie. Good morning, Ahmed. If I didn't say good morning. Good morning, Anthony. Wanda. So, not many questions this week, which is okay. It's pretty much what I had for you guys this week. So, if there's no questions, I just want to double go through the chat here real quick. Yeah, pretty quiet week. So, well, thank you, Jay. I'm glad you liked it, Wanda. You know, every week it's a little, you know, we take a little different bite of the apple. But, you know, I think one of the things that people, when they talk about asking good interview questions, I think one of the challenges is, you know, you have it. I'm trying to, I want to like say three things at the same time. In this world of transformation, I think the question really becomes all of the questions surrounding what transformation means. Who's leading it? What's the underlying company culture? Are they embracing it? Are they outsourcing it? Are they pretending? You know, there's some places that just think, oh, well, transformation's another project that we'll do. No, transformation's a little bit more than that, right? Transformation is the word transformation for a reason. So I think when you go in and you say to yourself, all right, well, wait a minute, if I come into this company, let me get a little bit better understanding. You know, who's the transformation leader? What does the budgets look like? How are they starting to take, you know, and when I use the culture in this sense, you know, how do you take the legacy work? Where's the legacy work fitting in? Are people being, you know, engaged to help on that journey? And I think it's a very different approach because you're kind of taking a top-down approach rather than just saying, oh, what's my job going to look like for the next 30, 60, 90 days? I think those insightful questions then get you to the second part of what we've talked about time and time again, about instead of being backward looking and saying, well, here's all the skills I've had over a period of time, you know, isn't that really great? It's, well, wait a minute, if I understand your structure of how you're transforming, here are some challenges that I've seen, and here's how I take my expertise and help take you forward. I think that positions you so much better in an interview. Uh-oh, I created a monster, Wanda. Good. What was the old grown-up riff? Reading is fundamental. Yeah, and Brian has the, you know, you need to challenge the status quo. I mean, that's hard to do. I mean, I have some experience in the status quo, and it really gets back to, you know, what is the management trying to drive? And if the management doesn't want to change, or the management doesn't understand change, it's hard to challenge the status quo. And I think that's, you know, if I were to pick up on what Brian just texted or commented on, it's, you know, if you're finding that people are using the word change as a word versus change as a true, you know, we are changing the organization. I think that's really what, if there's one thing you want to get out of the interview process, to me, it's that. Are they using the word or are they embracing the word? And that very subtle difference is going to tell you volumes about your experience. So as a verb, I like that, Brian. Yes, yes, yes. So again, another week in the books. Seems to be nice outside. I may actually try and take my bicycle out for the first time in a while because I haven't done that. And again, I hope you guys find value in it. I'll probably put this up later tonight. It's so wonderful to have a very fast internet connection because my uploads take a lot shorter time than they used to. Of course, it still takes YouTube a long time to process the 4K video, but eh, so be it. So, yeah, I like that, Brian. If people are resistant to challenge the status quo, you may be in the wrong organization. There's a lot to be said for that. So, all right, guys. Well, I think that's all I got for this week. Again, thanks for stopping in. And once again, we will do it again next Sunday. I look forward to seeing you then. And until then, stay safe, and we'll do it again next week. All right, guys. Bye.